So yesterday I did much less math than I was hoping to, so I did mostly the heuristics parts, and today I'll try to be more serious about theorems today. So let me first remind you where we arrived. So we arrived at Laughlin's function. So that's a function for n electrons or n quantum particles in the plane. Depends on an integer n. And I take the coordinates of the particles to be identified with complex numbers. I have a normalization constant which normalizes this in L2. And here is the form of the function. And B is still the value of an external magnetic field. So B is a positive number. N is an integer. So yesterday I started from discussing the actual fractional quantum Hall effect, where you need particles to be electrons. For them to be electrons, this must be anti-symmetric under exchanges of the Zi and Zj's. And in this case, you need the little n to be odd. But today I will forget this constraint and I will also consider even values of little n. In particular, n equal 2 is relevant. N equal 1 is a bit less interesting because n equal 1 corresponds to free fermions. So thank you all. I was really afraid that nobody was showing up, so we were just all late. That's right. That's fine. Okay. I have not said anything yet that I didn't say yesterday. Right, so Zi, Z1, Zn are complex numbers. What more can I say? That's it. Okay, so why is this function? Relevant. So what I tried to argue for yesterday was that it's relevant for a combination of a few reasons. So there was reason A, that it's fully analytic times Gaussian, namely that means it minimizes the magnetic kinetic energy, so it minimizes the energy in a many-body magnetic Laplacian. And the second motivation was called B, and it was that it vanishes when two particles come close so as to minimize repulsive interactions. So let me just combine these two for today. This function is introduced because it's supposed to be good at, with quotation marks, minimizing magnetic kinetic energy, so namely expectation value of a magnetic Laplacian as defined yesterday, plus interactions. But then there was C. This function has a filling factor nu equals 1 over n. And as I explained, filling factor nu equals 1 over n boils down to the fact that if you square mod square this, take the first marginal, to a good approximation, it's a constant function in a disk, and then it falls to zero rapidly. And then there was D. I can go here. It is expected to be robust against perturbations. Okay, so what I want to do today is A plus B for the general case of the fractional quantum effect stays at the heuristic level. So you do exactly minimize the magnetic kinetic energy, but you have to go to simpler cases to exactly minimize repulsive interactions. So I want to explain the only theorem that I know of that goes in the direction of vindicating this vague sentence. So this I want to do first. Then this C as filling factor nu equals 1 over n, that's one of the problems of the exercise sheet. So you will be doing this this afternoon. And I want to say something today, this morning, about theorems that give some kind of, we have been trying to give some meanings to this sentence D from a mathematical point of view. So, but first I will go to this. And this is, this will be the rigorous derivation of the Laughlin wave function with exponent 2, starting from a realistic model for quantum particles. But now I have to go a little bit away from the fractional quantum Hall effect. This will be for, not for electrons in a magnetic field, but for rotating bosons. The reason being that, so the situation of rotating bosons was considered in the cold atom physics community some years ago. And at some point, there was a real hope that one could create the Laughlin state in this context. It turned out not to be really doable with today's technology. But what is interesting from a mathematical point of view is this is a context and where the Laughlin phase function is actually exact in an asymptotic sense. It's not a heuristic thing that it should be good at minimizing an energy, is that you can prove in some limit that it does what you expect it to do. So this is a little bit different from yesterday, but not so much. So the setting here is, so I have to start from 3D. So I explain you a little bit why. So now the particles, I do not assume that they are 2D from the outset. They will become 2D in the limit taken. So 3D rotating bosons with short range interactions. And short range is important. The reason the Laughlin state is going to be exact is because it's very good at short range interactions, so because it vanishes when particles come close, but it does a priori nothing to long range interactions. And what is interesting is that for rotating bosons, so for cold atoms, if you don't know what cold atoms are, that's fine, so that's just a particular field of physics. In this field of physics, interactions are definitely short range. They are via S-wave scattering. Right, so let me write a model which looks very much like the one we had yesterday. The first difference is, what does it mean, bosons? Now we are looking for epsilon n, which is now in L2 symmetric n of R3n, because I start from 3D. Right, so yesterday we had anti-symmetric. Namely, when I exchange two arguments, I pick a minus sign. Here, if I exchange two arguments, I get nothing. In particular, one example is the Laughlin function here with exponent 2, where if I exchange zi and zj, I get the same function. Right, so the Hilbert space has changed. That's because these are bosons and not fermions like electrons. Let me start with the Hamiltonian with no interactions. So with no interactions, let me denote it by Hn0, acting on this space. So it's purely, since there are no interactions, it's purely a sum from 1 to n of one body term. And let me write it like that. I have minus usual, so this is usual kinetic energy, that's the p squared, that's the kinetic energy, so minus Laplacian on each variable. Then I have, so I should have written it down, so I no longer have room, so it's okay. So these will be rotating bosons in a quadratic trap, so that they are trapped by a field which produces an harmonic well, an harmonic potential well. So here it comes, so let me write it this way. There is a little omega, which is a number, and I square it, because that's the usual convention, mod of xj squared. So that's just a potential, that's a term which wants to keep the particles somewhere. Right, and then there is rotation. And rotation means I will be looking for the equilibrium state in the rotating frame. So here, this Hamiltonian is for bosons in the rotating frame. And I have to add, so let me denote it by omega vector dot, maybe j, dot lj, where I don't need this j, actually. Omega is the rotation vector, if you want, so it's 0, 0, and the scalar omega, just a number. This just means I'm rotating around the x3 axis. Maybe I draw a cartoon later. And L is angular momentum. So L is x vector product with minus I nabla. And I is imaginary unit. Right? What more do I need to say? I think it's fine like this. So, trap and this comes from the fact that I'm looking in the rotating frame. And maybe it's convenient just to make a connection. So omega is a number, let's say it's positive for convention. Little omega, well, it's positive, why not? It's a number fixed, fixed for the moment. And here you can complete a square in this to make an Hamiltonian looking more similar to what we had yesterday up here. So you can rewrite Hn0. Now there are two ways to do it. Let me choose one. Yes, well, that's like this. You can rewrite it like this. This one or the other? So minus I nabla 2D on particle J plus omega xj 2D perp square. By 2D I mean it acts only on the first two spatial coordinates. So this is a part which acts only on, if you want, the first and second coordinate of xj. Then, you see, I took only the two coordinates like this, so I will have to add, maybe I put it downstairs, minus d xj in the third direction squared, so that's the part of the Laplacian that I didn't take in this square. And, I have to complete a square. So here, what do I get? I'm going to get little omega squared minus capital omega squared, xj first coordinate squared plus xj second coordinate then squared. And also I have to have here omega squared xj3 squared. So that's a lot of sub indices and upper indices. I hope it's so fine. That's just a rewriting. And it has so that's a rewriting which is interesting physically because it means, what does that mean? I have separated Coriolis from centrifugal. I'm looking in the rotating frame. So putting omega here, xj, perp, is Coriolis effect. You can see this because you see it comes with the momentum here. So it means it affects only particles that move in the rotating frame. So that's a Coriolis thing. And this is centrifugal. Namely, it means you are trying to trap your particles, but at the same time, you rotate them. And rotating produces a centrifugal force, and the centrifugal force wants to kill the trapping. And in particular, you can see easily that if you want this to be bounded below, as an operator or as a quadratic form, that requires that little omega be larger than capital omega, because otherwise I can make this negative, and I can make the action of this operator on a wave function negative by locating the wave function where this guy is negative. So what's the physical picture? Maybe I draw a cartoon. I'm not very good at drawing cartoons, but let me try. So this would be x1, x2, well, upstairs, because these are the physical coordinates, not the labels of the particles. So I have a well. I have, in there, I have a cloud . So they are atoms, so maybe I say it once. These particles are atoms. And I'm going to make them rotate, it doesn't really matter, but I guess in this direction, with frequency omega around the x3 axis. So that's the physical situation. And so stability meaning the energy being bounded below, demands that little omega be larger than capital omega. So I have a limit that is set. I cannot rotate arbitrarily fast. And the idea that was around in the cold atom physics community a few years ago was, let's look at the limit where I rotate faster and faster. And I approach little omega from below. Because in this case, what is going to happen? You see here, I can separate these into roughly what's going on in the third direction in the plane. In the plane, the trapping disappears because of the centrifugal force. So then the cloud is going to expand in the plane, but it has fixed mass. So if it expands like this in the plane, it has to shrink in the third direction. So this cloud, if I rotate very fast, is going to, perhaps I can make an attempt at a cartoon. If I rotate fast, it's going to expand like this. So it's going to expand in this x1, x2 directions, and it's going to shrink in these directions. And while doing this, it becomes quasi 2D.
And fast going to little omega.
Yes, yes, yes. That would be written on the board at some point. So so the moment you approach the limit where this is becomes zero, then you shrink, so you become 2D, so you are in a good shape to start discussing quantumal stuff. And what? Well,
why would it shrink vertically?
Because, so it has to expand horizontally, right?
Okay,
but the mass is fixed.
Okay, but there you got the interaction, so. I mean, so why wouldn't just the atoms go outwards at the same height?
So I'm not sure I understand the question. So you are shrinking, you are expanding in this direction, and the quantity of atoms you have is fixed. So
why is the density fixed? The density
could
be become more
dilute. I have a trap in which I put a certain number of atoms, and then I rotate. Yeah.
So what happens? Well,
I get your point. Yeah, the density could become. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, so. That's the way you should think of it, and it's going to become a theorem if you want. Okay. Yes. The idea. I'm not sure I can go far. I'm not sure I should try to give more heuristics because I'm going to write a theorem anyway. Yes.
So if you increase big omega, you increase small omega also.
The idea is that I fix little omega, and then I increase big omega. I'm looking at this limit. Right? That's what I'm doing. You give yourself a little omega, not to infinity, yes, exactly.
The trap stays the same.
The trap stays the same, yes. Let's say it's 1. And then I look at the limit omega going to 1.
What you're saying is essentially that the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, where you suppose that they are from the ground state in the x3 direction, accurate.
Yes, that's what's going to happen, yes. What's going to happen is you kill this term. It has two effects. One is you want to minimize, the effect is that we want to minimize jointly these two terms, which is possible because these two operators commute. So you will be in the joint eigenspace of these two operators, so harmonic ground state of the harmonic oscillator in the three direction. And, well, now this is your favorite, or my favorite, magnetic Laplacian with constant magnetic field in the plane. So if you see, if you kill this guy, you minimize those jointly, the three directions become not interesting, and the plane directions become the Hamiltonian we had yesterday. So, right. Probably, yes.
So at this point,
in fact, without interaction, in fact, I can minimize everything jointly here. You're right. But once I switch on interactions, it will no longer be true. Right. So now I'm going to switch on interactions. So there's going to be another parameter, little a, and my Hamiltonian with interactions is HN0 plus a sum over pairs of an interaction potential, W, depending on a. And let's get the scaling right. W A of X is 1 over A squared W of X over A. Well, that was not the most brilliant blackboard management I did. Well, forget it. Okay, A is a positive number, and I will play with it to do some asymptotics. So it's going to vary when I take big omega to little omega. While W, it goes from R3 to R plus. So it's positive, in particular, it's a repulsive interaction. It's a fixed function. And let's take it smooth and decaying rapidly at infinity. Take it infinity with compact support if you want. I don't care. That's not the point of the theorem I'm going to write down. So it's a fixed, nice, smooth function that I scale in order to get a potential WA. It's made so that it has scattering lengths. A. For this to happen, I need that W as scattering length 1. And of course, I need to define what the scattering length is. So here it comes. So we take a function v, let's say from R, here we are from R3, let's take it from R plus because of to R plus because I don't really need anything else. So the scattering length A sub V, so the scattering length of this potential V, you can define it as saying 4 pi AV is the infimum of some energy, integral grad F squared plus half V F squared. So you want to minimize this quadratic form under the constraint that f is a function which has to go to 1 at infinity. So what is this? So f to 1 at infinity is that it's because you think of f as describing a defect in an homogeneous medium. So you have an homogeneous thing which is, say, has value 1, and then close to the place where you put a potential V, this wants to make a defect to avoid the potential. But at the same, so that's why you want to minimize V times F squared. That's the usual thing in quantum mechanics. But this is quantum mechanics, so at the same time that you want to avoid the defect, it doesn't want to have too high kinetic energy, which is this, grad F squared. So this is an effective description for the problem before of what two particles do when they are very close together and they kind of forget what the other particles are doing. Right? You might be wondering why this is called a length. The reason why is that, as always, I make a mess with units. I don't put units anywhere. Reason two, where you can clearly see why it's a length. So, and usually it's defined like that, actually. Take some f, well, df, which achieves the inf. It's not difficult to see that there is such a f that minimizes this. Well, for the record, it satisfies minus Laplace half plus half V F equals 0 with this particular boundary condition at infinity. And you see it has to go to 1 at infinity, but it goes to 1 in a particular way. You can prove that F of X is 1 minus A V over mod X times 1 plus little o of 1 when x becomes large. See that? That's why AV deserves the name of a length. It's because it's the, so to say, it's the rate at which it quantifies how fast you recover the homogeneous background one at infinity. Right, so now, this one goes up. V is a generic function, nice, smooth and compactly supported, yes. I mean, unless otherwise mentioned, any function that serves an interaction potential in this course is smooth and compactly supported. You don't need that much, of course, but I don't want to discuss regularity issues. That's also so implicit that I forget to mention such things. So perhaps it's still good to think of, okay. Smooth. Rotationally symmetric. Compact support. I certainly don't need that much, but let's stay on the safe side and not worry about anything else. And same for W, right? Do not hesitate to ask questions why the blackboards go up and down, because that's a real waste of time. So sure, it has to do with it's a two-body problem. Marcello, perhaps you can say something.
The interaction between the atoms can be seen as a scattering.
Yeah, that's how you have to see it. Is that your interactions are two atoms that come close to together and then they separate, and doing this they have exchange energy. So yes, there were two questions here. So first here.
I have a question regarding this infimum. Isn't it just more or less always zero if I assume compact support of B? I can, in principle, define this function f to be zero on a compact of B.
No, but
define this one at infinity, and I just somehow smoothly connected, and this smooth connecting.
Did I make some mess here?
And then I.
But that
this
that
sequence of f's such that this gradient where
we'll go to
goes from zero to one.
I don't think that's right. So, yeah, you have to pay some kinetic energy, yes, all the time. I mean, you will never be able to make the kinetic energy zero doing this, I guess.
Yeah, because I don't have a normalized
function. Yeah,
the f is not normal.
One way out is that if your V is compact, so is that fine? One way out is also
it's not normalized, so this gradient will not go.
Yeah, I think, yeah. And Niels, there were.
I just wanted to remark on the scattering length, right?
Yes?
I think the physicists think of it, so the equation in parentheses minus Laplace plus 1/2 V, you think of being the Schrödinger equation.
Yeah.
Two particles,
right,
that collide with their energy going to zero, right? And the A is something like you think of replacing the potential by hard balls of radius A. Isn't that not the thing to zero?
Yeah, that's one way to think of it. But I don't want really to enter too much details. I like the interpretation as that this AV is really the energy for two particles being close in my condensate. Okay, and now I would like to state the theorem. So I think I have all I need. Yes, I have all I need. So the theorem is going to be so that's Mathieu Levin, Robert Seiringer in 2009, I think, in the Journal of Statistical Physics, I think. So I do what I said before. I take the limit capital omega going to little omega. And perhaps And then I have another limit, which is these interactions become short range. And this means A going to zero, because if A goes to zero, you see this WA will be more and more going to a Dirac function. And while it does that, so it concentrates in a ball of radius A, and at the same time, you have something in front which diverges. So it becomes a very strong, but very short-range interaction. And that's the limit I want to consider, and that's the limit in which the Laughlin states become exact. So you're going to take the other way around. Capital omega goes to little omega. And at the same time, you're going to take little a to zero in such a way that little omega minus capital omega divided by a converges to a constant kappa. Positive. Right, so that's the limit. This difference goes to zero, this number goes to zero, but the ratio stays fixed, and I obtain a result depending on the value of this number. I take psi n, a sequence of ground states for the Hamiltonian HNA. So it's a sequence depending on little omega and A. N will be fixed. Perhaps I say it because that's going to be an open problem. Particle number is fixed. And I take, so you take one of the lowest eigenfunctions of this Hamiltonian, and you look at what it becomes when you let the parameters tend to what they should tend to. And then the theorem is, if kappa is small enough, so namely it's a small number independently of the limits you've taken, but unfortunately depending on n, then up to constant, I will explain this, up to the choice of a constant phase, in norm, psi n minus psi Laughlin with exponent 2 in L2 norm goes to 0. So when omega goes to little omega, and A goes to zero. And now I have to make a comment because I have abused notation here. Psi Laughlin 2 is very much related to the function upstairs, but it's not exactly that. What I mean by Psi Laughlin 2 here, it's a function of so these are 3D coordinates, and this is psi Laughlin 2, a normalization constant, product I less than j, zi minus zj 2, where zj is a complex number which is identified with the first two coordinates of xj. So it's identified with xj1, xj2. And then I have e to the minus something. So what plays the role of b here is omega. So if probably here I have to do something like omega is b over 2. Right, so something like, omega. Maybe there is a half, I don't remember. Sum of zj squared. So these are all, this is a, for the moment a 2D wave function, but I started from 3D bosons, so I have to say what goes on in the third direction, but the third direction is completely decoupled. So I have also e to the minus, there is a half, omega half sum for j from 1 to n of the third coordinate of each particle squared. Yeah, if you want, it shrinks. In that, it achieves the minimum length you can have in the third direction due to the harmonic oscillator in this direction.
In case a sequence cyan, but you agree that n is
fixed,
but
the yeah, so I just want to recall that it's a many-body wave function, but as a sequence, it's better to say that it's a sequence which is indexed by A. And omega and capital N is a fixed number. So yes, maybe it's a little bit disturbing for people who don't know many-body quantum mechanics all the time. So perhaps it's better said like that. Okay. So that's a theorem. I cannot really give the proof. That would be a lecture in its own, and I want to discuss something else. Maybe I mention an important open problem. It's related to what I call the main open problem in the exercise sheets, namely the spectral gap for an effective Hamiltonian. Is that kappa here? How to say it? Maybe here I say kappa must be smaller than a number kappa zero, which a priori depends on n, kappa zero of n, is this kappa zero n independent of n. People believe it's true, but it's an open problem. It's related to the spectral gap of an effective Hamiltonian. Because the see the main strategy to prove this is that there is a natural toy model for which the Laughlin state is exact that is discussed in the exercise sheets. And the idea is that in this limit, the full Hamiltonian reduces to this model Hamiltonian. But now there are certain properties of this reduced Hamiltonian which are still open, in particular as regards the limit n to infinity. So what is done in this paper by Levin and Saringer is produce upper and lower bounds to the energy, reproducing the effective model Hamiltonian. And to my knowledge, this is the only existing theorem that derives really the Laughlin state from a genuine many-body problem in a realistic limit. And unfortunately, this is not something that experimentalists managed to do, but that's, I think, a nice justification of using this wave function, at least for exponent 2. All right, so if you have questions on these statements, now is a good moment to ask them, because I'm going to move to some other topic. So, yes?
Yeah, so that lemma is taken independently of n then, because first you wrote n, and now the norm, I mean. There is not a convergence in the particles, I mean, it just to zero and omega to capital omega, right?
Yes. Okay. Yes. The particle number is fixed.
Okay, yes.
Fixed all the time in this theorem.
Okay.
And the open problem is to be able to get rid of this assumption.
Okay, yes. Okay.
Yes. The limit function is just the Laughlin function, so yes, it doesn't not depend on k. I mean, it still depends on omega, which you can take to be one. This is not fixed, right? Perhaps I should better do it like that. Okay. No, the Laughlin function depends on nothing. That's the Laughlin wave function. Period.
Can the limit capable be equal to zero?
If the limit kappa is equal to zero,
the scattering length decreases slow.
No, I think you get something trivial if you do that. So kappa to zero is. No, okay, kappa zero is okay. If you take kappa equal to zero, because kappa equal to zero is kappa, certainly kappa small enough, so it is, yes, it's fine. But in fact, having kappa fixed is the relevant regime to get the full model Hamiltonian, which again is in the exercises. So that's the natural scaling is really to fix this ratio and not make it go to infinity nor to zero. So otherwise, you have a model Hamiltonian with two terms, and you would get only one of the terms in the limit.
The limit Hamiltonian has delta interactions.
Yeah, it has delta interactions projected on the lowest Landau level, yeah. Which makes sense because delta interactions do not make sense on their own. Okay. So if no further questions, I move to D. So I want to say something in the direction that the Laughlin wave function is robust against perturbations. And here, let's go back a little bit to the fractional contour mole effect. Well, I said yesterday, so there are three main players. By order of importance, there was the magnetic field, which forces your wave functions to be analytic times Gaussian. Then there is a repulsive interaction that you hope will force your wave function to be of the form, to have this factor here, this correlation factor, making particles want to avoid one another. But then there is also, importantly, an external potential whose effects should not be neglected, because if you do neglect it, you don't get fractional contour mole effect. You don't get these nice plateaus from the experimental pictures. So it is of interest to try to understand what happens to this function if you try to perturb it with an external potential. And now, a lot of the work we did in these last years with mostly with Jacob Ingvarsson and also with Eliot Lieb and Sylvia Serfati is try to formulate a mathematical problem that one could solve, because if you formulate a problem that you cannot solve, it's a bit, well, useless, which goes in this direction. So it's kind of a toy model, which it has what I think is a very interesting structures, and I want to explain that. So part D, why is that robust against perturbations? So perhaps the first thing is what to say, what are natural modifications of Laughlin's function. So the point I want to make is that this function is just the simplest of its kind, and all the arguments that I gave to motivate this form work just as well to motivate the form that I will write down here. Define psi capital F to be C capital F So unless otherwise mentioned, all little c's mean the function which is on the left here is L2 normalized by this number. It's the Laughlin function, say with exponent n, times f of z1, zn, with f analytic in each variable and symmetric. Namely, it doesn't change if I permute two arguments. Good. So the point of looking at these guys is that they seem to do A plus, well, it's not that they seem, it's that they actually do this, plus B just as well as the pure Laughlin function, which is F equal to 1. So when I say I want to minimize magnetic kinetic energy plus interactions, and I think I need analytic times Gaussian, and I need these correlation factors, what is it that prevents me from doing something much more complicated than the Laughlin state and multiply it by an arbitrary analytic function of n variables and just symmetric? I demand symmetric because then that preserves the symmetry of the Laughlin function. If Laughlin is anti-symmetric, then psi f is anti-symmetric. And if Laughlin is symmetric, then psi f is symmetric. So why not do that? The first answer is, you pick the simplest function of its kind. You test it against experimental data, and if it works, you're happy. So fair enough. I think it's a fair answer. But can we do some math to go a little bit more in this direction? Perhaps I say something more, is that such a function, it doesn't do C exactly. What about C? So what about the filling factor of such a function? The rationale is that the moment you increase the degree of an analytic function by multiplying like this, you always decrease the filling factor. So that is something that you should have as an intuition. So this really should have a filling factor strictly less than 1 over n. So you could say, well, I consider the Laughlin wave function as primordial because it has filling factor exactly 1 over n in the thermodynamic limit. But if you remember the plots of the fractional quantum Mole effect, the plateau is centered at nu equals 1 over n, but it extends in both ways around. So it makes sense to ask what happens for smaller filling factors in particular. For larger filling factors, I don't know what to do. But for smaller, it certainly makes sense also. And so it's important to understand what goes on at smaller filling factors. And it's an important part of Laughlin's paper of 1983 that he argues that, OK, fine, all these functions could be relevant, but there are some that are simple and that are more relevant than others. And these are called now functions with Laughlin quasi-holes. So if you learned a little bit of condensed matter physics, the moment something is called quasi-something, that should ring a bell. That's the moment where you will identify what are the quasi-particles of your theory, namely what are the effective particles that you should consider as being responsible for an effect. The composite objects that allow you to simplify your theory and not think in terms of fundamental particles. So this, formally it's you take psi little f, so it's, now there is going to be a little f, there is a c little f, which again normalizes, there is a psi Laughlin, and there is a very simple capital F, product j from 1 to n, f of zj, and little f is analytic, complex analytic. Right. So that, I think, I hope we all agree this is the simplest function of the kind that was upstairs, except for capital F equal 1. That's the simplest modification thereof. So why do I talk about quasi-holes? Is that F is analytic, so it's a little bit more general than a polynomial, but not so much, in particular because this has to be stay square integrable. So let's think of it as a polynomial. If you write it like that, product k from 1 to k of z minus some complex numbers ak to some integer powers mk's. So ak is a complex number in the plane, mk an integer. These, so argues Laughlin, are the quasi-particles of the theory. They are the locations of a natural excitation of the Laughlin state, and all the physics of the Laughlin, of the fractional quantumhole effect, is about the Laughlin state is, if you wish, the vacuum of the theory, the new vacuum. You generate excitations on this vacuum, and these are these excitations are the ones who carry charge or get trapped or do fancy thing, or if you want. But you're not interested in just in the Laughlin wave function, the ground state on its own. You're interested in its elementary excitations, and these are believed to be the elementary excitations. So these are, now they are just fixed numbers, so they are the locations for the moment. They are classical, so they are excitations and quasi-particles. That's what physicists mean by quasi-particles. It's the object you should consider. And the reason they are called quasi-holes in sense of quasi-particle, I'm too much French here. They are called holes instead of particles, I will explain just now. And I think that's the only moment where I will really explain my title, saying that there is fractional quantization, is that these guys so the main claim, well, the main claim, not of these lectures, but the main claim that got Laughlin famous is the claim that these quasi-particles carry a fraction of an electron charge. So these are your effective particles, and they carry a fraction, namely 1 over little n, of an electron charge. And that was really a very, very new concept at the time, because so these are the quasi-particles. So first of all, well, the fraction of a number that you thought was really the fundamental unit of charge is a bit shocking, but that's fine because you know that electrons are made of, you could think of quarks electrons are not made of quarks, but you could think of quarks who do have a fractional charge, but to see quarks, you need gigantic energies, and quarks are fundamental particles. They are just one object. Here, this quasi-particle is made of all the electrons. It's not like you're binding a few particles together to make a new particle. Like you say, well, I don't want to think of an atom in terms of protons, neutrons, electrons. I do put everything together under the hat atom. Here, this quasi-particle is not like that. It's made of the collective motion of all the electrons you had in your sample. So let me So this is something that is hinted at in the exercise sheets, so I don't want to spend too much time on it, but let me at least draw a cartoon. I used to have some notes. Let me at least draw a cartoon of why these guys are believed to have a fractional charge. So one day I will find my notes again. So here it's a vague claim again, but each little ak carries 1 over little n units of charge. How to see this? So you may remember that if I have a wave function, I am interested in looking at the density of a wave function psi n, which I recall. Now it's a function of just one coordinate. It's
it was not mk, so
Certainly. Thanks. But what it means, you see, you can think of putting two at the same place. MK is equal to two is putting two at the same place, so you still think that each one had one over little n as its charge.
So it should be one over n times MK, right? MK should be the denominator.
No. It's
according to what you just said.
It's one over MK over n. If mk is 1, the interesting case is mk is 1, and it's 1 over n. So let me just recall this definition. If you take your wave function psi n, this, and you integrate over the dots. Now, this is part of the exercises, but you may remember that I argued for the fact that, well, I stated the fact that if you take the density of just the bare Laughlin state, viewed from the top, it looks like this. It's a disk. Okay. From top. So it's a 2D. This is a 2D function, and I'm just looking from above the plane. This is a disk like that with in here constant rho like B over 2 pi little n. So what does rho psi little f do? At least, okay, if I don't make too much of a mess, if I don't choose a pathological situation for where the AKs are and what the MKs are, it's going to look like this. So the disk is slightly larger, and I have around each AK a small hole. So here, the density rho is still b over 2 pi little n. And here in the hole, the density rho is almost zero. And each one, I mean, at the center of the hole here, you have the coordinate of one of your, the parameters of your functions. Right. So it's a cartoon, so don't try to take it too seriously. You will see in the problems that you can justify this to some extent. What is important is that you started from something completely flat, and you just pierced all in this. That's the name quasi-holes. And now, why fractional charge? If I take, so let's call this one, this particular one, let's call it hole, number k. If I take the integral over this hole, number k, of the original density, the unperturbed one, that would be mk over little n. And I think it's OK because I took charge to be 1, so that's fine. Yes, exactly. That's what it is. The AK.
You get some interaction with these fixed virtual particles that you add in the.
Yes. That's one way to think of it, certainly. Yeah. So.
It's psi F?
No, it's psi Laughlin. So I'm going to explain this. Yeah. So here, there. I just want to check that I didn't make an. There's no MK in the Laughlin state, quite right. It just defines the hole. So let's put it upstairs. What does that mean? Is that you have removed around this location of the Laughlin state a charge, which is a charge, because here a unit of charge is 1, so the charge is proportional to density. So you have removed some charge. Sorry. MK over little n, well, n is the exponent of the Laughlin function. So the difference between these two guys is that you create charge deficiencies, because the charge you would have had in the pure Laughlin wave function would be this. in this hole, but you have removed this part. And in fact, you have sent it, since the charge is preserved, you have sent it to the boundary, if you like. And that's why these guys are called, or believed to have fractional charge. And it has been measured in experiments that the quasi-particles of the quantum Hall effect, fractional quantum Hall effect do have fractional charges. They also are believed to have fractional statistics, something I wanted to discuss, but I will certainly not have time. So, but okay, I'm around if you want to know what fractional statistics are and why these guys do have fractional statistics. Okay, so far I have just told you these are the natural modifications of Laughlin's function. There is a very general modification here, but for physical reasons, you would like to know that you can reduce to these simplified perturbations. And now the question is, to do what exactly? The answer is to minimize what I have neglected so far. So the spirit is, I will consider all these guys I'm as my candidates for minimizing the energy that I have not taken into account yet, namely the external potential. And I will prove that if you do it like this, you can reduce to this simpler class with only Laughlin quasi-holes. So let me put equations on this. So it's in the spirit of perturbation theory, if you want, except that it's not totally exact because you don't know the Laughlin state is really an exact ground state of something. But the idea is that so you have a first energy scale, which is the magnetic field. So you set yourself in the lowest space for this energy scale, so the ground state of this operator. And you see, okay, it's hugely degenerate. So you have not selected a unique ground state yet. Then you add interactions within this space you're already restricted to, and you say, well, this restricts further my class of states, and here it becomes a bit end wavy, is that you restrict this, your guess is only those will be relevant, for example, because they are exact ground states of model Hamiltonians, so let's reduce to this new space, to reduce again. But then it's still hugely degenerate, because I still have as many states as I have analytic functions symmetric of n variables. And the question is, now I have a third energy scale, which is external potential. Does the external potential reduce further the class of possible states? So that's the spirit. So like, it's like perturbation theory, where you minimize something in the ground state or something else, except that also that the fact that it's a ground state here is a bit end wavy. So I'm going to formulate a problem. So what I want, you can call it response of the Laughlin state to potentials. Now I'm going to have an extremely simple energy functional. E sub v of psi n is just going to be psi n sum of v of xj psi n in L2 for a nice function v, on which I will put assumptions later because I have to state a true theorem, which is, so it's the same as the integral of v rho psi n. This you can figure out. Well, it's trivial. So the rationale for considering only this v is the v from the first lecture that I have neglected so far. So I reintroduce it again. V models trapping in the sample and impurities. So this is a very simple energy. The thing is that, of course, if I minimize it over all L2 wave functions, this doesn't make sense at all. Well, it does make sense. You're just going to converge to Dirac at the minimum point of this. That's not very interesting. So the energy is trivial. What is not trivial at all is the space over which I'm going to minimize this, or perhaps infimize this, because I don't want really to ask the question whether there is a minimizer. But I'm going to define some numbers, which are my energies. Capital EV depends, so it depends on the particle number and the exponent of the Laughlin wave function that I choose, is going to be the infimum of EV of psi f of the form, well, this form, meaning this blackboard. And of course, I want to demand L2 normalization. So what is this? This is the lowest potential energy I can achieve while constraining myself to be of this form. Now there is a little e sub v capital E on n. It's the same. Except that I further restrict the set of functions I want to consider. So of the form upstairs. So beware that psi capital F and psi little f really refer to different things. Little f will always be a function of one variable, and capital F will always be a function of n variables. Right? And of course, I also demand this. And perhaps I want to define the third quantity, EBT. BT stands for bathtub. Those who have read Liblos sympathize with me at this point. Where is that? Yes. That's the infimum of the integral of V rho. So this is an R2, where I demand that rho be a function satisfying this. Here you may recognize this is the density of the Laughlin state, and integral of rho equals to n. So these three numbers are just the they are just the infima of the same energy within different classes of functions. So the E capital V is the energy minimized over all possible perturbations of the Laughlin state. Little e is a simplification thereof, and the bathtub energy is the minimizer of this amongst functions rho, now function of one variable, that I demand be positive because they are densities, and be bounded above by some constant. And this is called the bathtub principle, because you can think of it as you're filling, you think of V, the level sets of V, as giving you the shape of a bathtub, and you think of filling it with water, and this, the solution of this problem gives you a rho bathtub. And I encourage you to look at Liblos, the book Analysis by Liblos, for this discussion. Right. And now the theorem is that, of course, if I introduce three numbers, it's just to prove that they are the same. The last one you can explicitly compute, that's right. I will mention it in a moment. The last one, the minimizer, well, at least one minimizer saturates the constraint. which means you put maximum density of water at the bottom of your bathtub, which does make sense. So, I'm going to assume something. See, V, for the moment, I've not specified. I've just said it's a function. I need to put assumptions, and I don't really want to try to be general. I want that V is of the V of X is in fact chosen depending on N, and it's of the form U of X over root N. U is a fixed function. And why do I want to do that? Well, the reason is that the Laughlin wave function, I'm going to take the limit n to infinity now, thermodynamic limit of large particle number. And the Laughlin wave function, as you will see in these exercises, it has to live on a scale of order root n, simply because it has constant density, and the density has to integrate to n. And so you are in 2D, so it has to live on a scale of the root n. So what I'm doing with this is that I'm considering perturbations that live on this same scale, because it's more manageable. So it's not really the best we can do, but I don't want to enter into too many technical details. So U is fixed. It's, say, smooth. And trapping, meaning it goes to infinity at infinity. You can think of it as it has a trap path, which mounts to keep the particles in some region. And on top of that, it can do anything so that it's, so far as it's smooth. So I can add, so if you want an impurity path, which does something completely random, except I want it to be regular. Ouais.
If it is increasing, it means that this guy is exactly the minimizer.
If it's just purely increasing, yes, but that's not trivial to see. Right? I mean, if U is harmonic, if it's quadratic, it's true that the Laughlin state is an exact ground state of it. But it's already very non-trivial to see, if I even take just U to be x to the 4, or to the 6, or to the 20, it's already non-trivial to prove that the Laughlin state is an approximate minimizer within this class. That's part of the statement I'm going to write. That's non-trivial. And so the theorem says so this is joint work with Elliot Lieb and Jacob Ingvarsson. And well, the punchline is from 2 years ago. By the way, I still have other fixed other parameters floating around. So B, little n is fixed. B is fixed. And then the statement says E, V, the ratio of these two numbers I defined goes to 1 when capital N goes to infinity. And in fact, so this is already a simplification, you see. This capital E is defined using all the capital Fs, all the analytic functions of many variables. This little e is defined using only functions or analytic functions of one variable. But it's also true, and in fact it's the part of the proof, that this divided by the bathtub energy that you can compute, this ratio goes to 1 also when n goes to plus infinity. right? So what this is saying is that I have restricted myself to quote-unquote all the ground states of the magnetic kinetic energy plus the interaction. Then within this space, I minimize what's left of the energy, neglecting what might be left of the interactions. I minimize what's left of the energy, namely the potential energy. And the answer I get is that it's sufficient to minimize it, at least in the thermodynamic limit, to consider only quasi-all perturbations of the Laughlin state. So you don't need to worry about possible complications, possible capital F, which might be more complicated. And now, so I had planned to give elements of proofs, but I certainly cannot do that in 10 minutes. So I will just comment on these theorems, you know, this theorem. And if you want to know something about the proof, I'm available during the breaks. So what could be the first comment? Well, the first comment maybe is that this has a corollary, or the proof of the corollary, if you want. The corollary is if you take psi n, which is psi f depending on n, so if you take a sequence of functions f little n, if you take a sequence like that of quasi-minimizers, as I said, I don't really want to consider whether there is a minimizer for this. So quasi-minimizers mean the energy of these guys is the infimum times 1 plus little o of 1 when n goes to infinity. Yeah.
I have a question about this theorem. If I listen well, you're saying that if you're allowed to perturb the Laughlin state by adding something to the powers nk, then some combination of this would be super close to the actual ground state energy.
Yeah.
But in this, do you have some results about the are the nk's bounded or controlled by something like
Not quite. What we have is a trial state construction with a way to choose the AKs and the MKs so as to achieve the infimum energy. Okay. But we cannot quite prove that the minimizer does have some AKs and MKs and that are located in some way. The best we can do about the minimizer is what I'm going to write just now. So there is not necessarily a minimizer, but if I take you see such a sequence that gives almost the good energy, then rho psi n, again defined as before, I have to be a little bit careful and may adjust this weird symbol. It is close to the bathtub. My rows and my e's, I'm sorry, are really too similar. The rho bathtub, so minimizing the e bathtub of v. This is not meant to be a quotation mark close. This is meant to be they are close in total in L1 or total variation. But since both depend on n, I cannot quite say that they converge. Right? So it just means that the norm of the difference is much less than the norm of one of them. Okay, and a remark is that, as you maybe know, the bathtub minimizer is exactly of the form, so b over 2 pi n, namely the constraint I set on the density, times the indicative function of a set, let's call it S-bathtub. S-bathtub is an open set in R2. So in particular, the density of quasi-minimizers looks very much like what I drew over there, namely it's flat, or it has holes, but it doesn't have values in between the b over 2 pi n and the zero. It's either zero or b over 2 pi n. And then the one I want to get down is... So that's one comment. Another comment is that there is something else that was neglected when I restrict to the Laughlin states plus perturbations. Is that so? What the Laughlin state is actually good at is minimizing the short range part of the interactions. If you have a singularity in the interaction, the Laughlin wave function is very good at killing this one. But you don't really know what it does to the long range part of the interaction. So now this is a generalization with my postdoc Alessandro Olgetti. So I don't want to state it as theorem because. Okay, it's a theorem, but we still have to check the proof once more because before I can write theorem above it. So, with Alessandro, it works as well. If you add let's write it like that. If you start not from just sum of V of xj's, but from something which is sum of, so let's write it like that, U of xj over root n, as I had before, plus, here I have to locate the part of the notes where I have this. Yeah, it works as well if you add some interactions scaled in a proper way. Lambda over n, w xi minus xj over root n. W again. Say smooth. Here, I do not want to cheat too much. We do not need smoothness, but we do need regularity. The reason being that we think of the long range part of the interaction. So this certainly is not allowed to have a singularity, or not too strong a singularity when particles come close. So here, some regularity is used, so it's not just that I put smooth because I don't want to put assumptions. And fixed. And lambda, so lambda is a positive number, if you wish, less than some lambda zero. So long as it's not mine, it's OK. Right. So what I do here is that I add previously this term, just external potential. And here I add another term, which I consider as being what is left of the interaction that is not taken into account by the vanishing of the Laughlin function close to particle encounters. And the reason why it's scaled in this funny way is again that you have to remember that where you have to, the wave functions live on a scale root n. The scaling is just made so that these two terms are of the same weight in the limit. And you need, so with lambda fixed, the two are of the same order. And if lambda is smaller than a fixed number independent of n, lambda zero, then you get the same result, namely you define energies capital E, little e, E bathtub, if you wish, with the same definition except that I replace everywhere E sub V by E sub V plus the interaction energy, and the result stays the same, essentially. Right. So now I should stop here. Maybe I had one or two more comments, but I think it's a good place to stop. And no, it doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to be. You see, it's not a problem at all that it might be attractive, because in fact all these functions have a uniform density upper bound. So it's not a problem if there is an attractive part. These functions are not allowed to concentrate their mass to take advantage of an attractive part. So that's why maybe it seems a little bit weird, but that's the reason. Okay, so thank you. That's all.